I have a special Outdoors Weekly for you this week. As a nuclear expert, we'll debunk 5 common myths about nuclear energy, such as, can a nuclear power plant really blow up like a nuclear bomb? She'll address this and more as she shares her knowledge and experience in this field of clean energy. I'm Koaw, this is Casual Outdoors Weekly, and this week we're doing things a little bit different. We're going to interview an expert in the field of nuclear energy. With me, I have Natalie McIntosh. I'm saying that right?
Yep.
Very good. She has been working in the field of nuclear energy for 13 years. She's a mechanical engineer, a former chair of the American Nuclear Society Chicago branch. What got you into the field of nuclear energy?
Well, you know, Koaw, when I was in college, I realized that we had great energy needs, and we are currently using a lot of carbon dioxide emitting sources. So I wanted to be a part of the solution, the nuclear solution. And so I got involved right outside of college.
Oh, that's great. Can you explain for some of us that are a little not up on nuclear energy, what exactly is nuclear energy and how do we use it?
So nuclear energy, Koaw, is just a fancy way of boiling water. How we use most of our energy, except for wind and solar, is we boil water to turn a turbine, which turns a generator, which sends the electricity down those lines that you're familiar with on your street and into your outlet. So when you boil water with coal or natural gas, you burn it. Maybe biomass, like wood, you burn it, right? That's intuitive. But to make the heat from nuclear, we take the nucleus of an atom and we break it apart.
And that's different from fusion. You're talking about fission.
That's right. That's fission. Fusion is where you bring it together, and that's always 20 years away.
Always 20 years away. Okay. So thanks again for coming out to my office. I know we couldn't be in your office today, but let's debunk some myths. I think my viewers really want to know this, and you're the perfect person to ask. So first one, I know that we're exposed to different types of radiation every day. Is it fact or myth that most of that comes from nuclear power plants?
That's myth, definitely. Yeah. So you get more radiation from flying in an airplane, from living in the home because there's radon sources. You know, the average person gets about 1 millirem a day just being alive from the sun, from the earth. You know, if you have granite countertops in your kitchen, you're getting a few millirem every year. And you're going to get more from living by a coal-fired power plant, believe it or not, than nuclear. So that's definitely a myth.
All right, you heard it. That one's a myth. All right, next question. Nuclear energy is bad for the environment. Fact or myth?
Myth again. So we talked about carbon dioxide emissions. Everybody knows about global warming / climate change.
Can't avoid it.
It's a huge problem. And, you know, nuclear has been about 20% of our energy needs since about 1980. Even as population growth into, you know, we're in 2019 now.
Mm-hmm.
The future with electric cars, you're going to need a clean energy source to power all those cars. Are you going to get it from coal or natural gas?
That's a great point.
No.
Electric cars would be, they'd still be plugging all that carbon into the environment if they were running off coal power plants and other fossil fuels.
Yep.
I'm thirsty and I need my mug, and my cameraman's actually going to deliver it.
Okay.
This is a very important mug to me. Okay, so fact or myth? There is absolutely way too much waste from nuclear energy and it's too dangerous to dispose of.
That's definitely a myth. So let's compare this to the existential crisis that we're having right now with all of the carbon dioxide that's being pumped into the Earth's atmosphere that's going to affect the entire globe. It's huge. And there's like the sludge piles. They're massive. Where do they put the coal waste? In comparison, the high-level radioactive waste over a 60-year lifespan of the nuclear industry would fit onto a single football field about 10 yards deep. That's
nothing.
That's pretty tiny.
So nuclear energy's been around for what, 60 years, and you're saying all of that waste could fit into a football field 10 yards deep?
The high level waste, yes.
High level waste.
And so we, right now, So we don't have a Yucca Mountain solution, which is, I think, what the public is most concerned about. But right now, that high-level waste is sitting at most plants. In fact, I've walked up. They're in canisters. I've walked up. You know, I've given the canister a hug. It has next to no radiation. They're safe. So they're currently being stored very safely. Great. Yeah, we do need to come up with a better long-term solution, and it's going to require public support.
That's you. Question number four. It's unsafe to work in a nuclear power plant, and it's unsafe for the nearby citizens. Is this a fact or a myth?
That's definitely a myth. So you might be thinking, though, well, Natalie, Fukushima happened.
Japan?
In Japan. And for those of you who don't know what Fukushima is, basically there was a severe natural disaster.
Tsunami, right?
Yes, it was an earthquake, but it was the tsunami that took out the nuclear power plant. Mm-hmm. And there was actually nobody at that plant that was killed directly from the nuclear radiation. And I remember, because it was 3/11/11, never forget, I was working at a plant less than 50 yards away from an operating reactor, very much similar to the Fukushima reactor, and we were thinking to ourselves, holy could this happen here, right? And we realized that, you know, so we were like, well, what if there was a nuclear disaster? And we looked through a lot of our design bases, and we looked through a lot of our design, and we realized, you know, the operating procedures and everything. We had made a lot of changes, actually, because of, since 9/11, with the terrorist attack on the Twin Towers, a lot of changes were made in the nuke plants that then allowed us to beef up the safety of the plants. And actually, ever since Fukushima, the nuclear industry in America has come up with a new flex strategy, where we basically have two warehouses located at different ends of the United States with basically standard fittings and extra pumps and helicopters to fly that stuff to the location. Because, you know, I think a lot of people are like, well, what if something beyond the design basis happens, yeah, like Fukushima? Well, you know what?
You're ready for it.
We're ready. We're ready.
That's very good. Last question, and I think we're all curious about this one. Can a nuclear power plant, like one of the ones you work in every day, can that blow up like a nuclear bomb?
Myth.
That's a myth. Okay.
So the short answer is, you know, we just don't have our uranium enriched to the levels that we need. I know, like, we're concerned with other countries having, you know, highly enriched uranium. Mm-hmm. You know, in the United States, we're only allowed to enrich our U-235 to about 5% in a commercial reactor. And that prevents that from occurring. I mean, also the style of the reactor. You might be thinking about the Chernobyl incident from 1986. I mean, the history of the nuclear industry is very well versed to everybody in the nuclear industry.
Yes.
Because we have to learn, because it's going to be our future, and we need to make sure we don't make the same mistakes again. They had a different style reactor. They also weren't following procedures. They were outside of process. They had a mindset that they would kind of, mm-hmm, you know, not take safety seriously. And as a result, you know, I think it was 56 people actually died that day at Chernobyl, and it was the most horrific event of nuclear. Mm-hmm. And actually, Chernobyl today has become a beautiful environmental paradise with animals everywhere because all of the people are gone.
But the animals have residual radiation
That's
in them.
True. So it's not like a feel-good, happy story, but it's definitely one of those situations where, you know, Chernobyl is a tiny little landmass, mm-hmm, versus carbon dioxide.
The entire globe.
Which affects the entire globe that you can't escape from. There's never a silver bullet. You know, there's not a single energy source that is perfect. You know, maybe fusion, which is 20 years away, will be that silver bullet. But we're not there yet.
All right. Well, thank you very much. So we do a Nature is Nifty segment on our Outdoors Weeklies, and I think you have a really cool thing you want to talk about.
Yeah, Koaw, you should look into the natural reactors that occurred in Africa millions of years ago. They used uranium, much like our reactors today use uranium. They weren't a problem. Very interesting. They were self-sustaining.
Self-sustaining natural nuclear reactors in Africa. Okay, I'll look it up.
And I did look it up as Natalie pointed me to a great resource. Basically, about 2 billion years ago, there are at least 17 natural nuclear fission reactors under what is now known as Gabon in Western Africa. Remember that nuclear power is generated by uranium when those uranium atoms fission or break down, sending off fast neutrons, thus releasing nuclear energy. If those neutrons are slowed by a moderator or a go-between substance like water, other atoms could be triggered to experience fission as well. If the conditions are controlled and just right, this fission can occur for a very long time until the uranium depletes. In the case of these natural reactors, they operated for around 1 million years. Also note that the radioactive products from the fission in these natural reactors has been safely contained for more than 2 billion years, thus demonstrating that containing these radioactive materials is quite possible. Essentially, there are four requirements for a natural nuclear reactor to form. Firstly, the uranium ore must have a high uranium content with a thickness of about a meter, as well as a certain geometric shape that assists the chances for spontaneous natural fission in uranium-238 that then induces the self-sustaining fission in uranium-235. Secondly, the uranium must contain a lot of uranium-235. Basically, that's the strong stuff. And our nuclear power plants today have to enrich their uranium-238 with more uranium-235 before it gets put into use. Thirdly, there needs to be a go-between substance like graphite or water to slow the neutrons when uranium fission occurs. Finally, near the uranium, there can't be too much concentration of neutron-absorbing elements around, like silver, iridium, or boron, that would impede the nuclear reaction. And so these natural reactors weren't putting out too much power, only around 100 kilowatts, or enough to run maybe 1,000 light bulbs, whereas our nuclear reactors today put out around maybe 1,000 megawatts or so, enough to light 10 million light bulbs. Nevertheless, it's pretty damn cool that nature on Earth produced its own nuclear reactors. I'll link a great read to this resource that explains so much more how these natural reactors occurred, as well as other very cool nuclear energy resources that Natalie's pointing me towards, and I put those in the description below.
So, dealer's choice, I think we should just thank Natalie for stopping by and sharing her expertise.
Thank you, Koaw, for taking me to your wonderful outdoor laboratory.
Yes, beautiful. my office, my laboratory. Bit windy today, but still nice. If you have any questions that you want this nuclear expert to answer, put them in the comments, and I will make sure that she gets an answer to you. I'll respond. I will channel her words to the comments for you. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you again, and I hope to see you next week, and I hope you keep doing great things in the nuclear industry.
All right. Thanks, Koaw.